Scripture, Old Testament and New Testament, talk about the different places, different levels of hell, Sheol in the Old Testament, the New Testament, and I was going to dig in that there is no purgatory, that is not scripture at all, that there's heaven or hell after you die now that Christ came. Before Christ, though, when people died, they didn't go directly to hell, they went in some waiting place, and that's who Jesus Christ went and got after he died on the cross. So what I thought I would do is I would relate hell best to you guys with modern material today, something you would remember, because I know from previous experiences, a pastor standing up talking about hell, talking about things in front of people, goes in one ear and out the other. We would leave here and that would be it. You guys might say, wow, Andrew talked about hell, that's kind of crazy, but you guys wouldn't take anything from it, because I knew in the past I would never. So go on, next slide. All right, what is hell? Hell is a place waiting the non-believer. Eternity is the most important thing there is, meaning people are on their way to hell. We as believers should be encouraged to want to get them to heaven. So we need to preach to them. That's the Great Commission. That's what Jesus Christ told us to do. We're all born in sin. We're all on our way to hell, and we need someone to preach the gospel, the good news, so they could go to heaven. For every American that believes that they're going to hell, there's 120 people that think they're going to heaven. This is, just think about that stat. Every person that says, yeah, I'm going to go to hell, there's 120 people saying, well, I'm going to heaven. But this is just the opposite of Jesus' teaching, because in Matthew 7:13, it says, enter through the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. So Jesus is just saying the opposite. He says, enter through the narrow gate, because a lot of people are going to hell. That's a hard reality to face, but that's truth. Is it stuck?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you might have to go back one. Go back one real quick. Okay, never mind. You're good.
All right, go ahead.
Yeah, forward one.
Sorry about that.
Okay, no, you're fine. Satan. Who is Satan? Satan is the accuser. He's a fallen angel. Ultimately, he is the ruler of this world and of hell. He's the prince of this world. Scripture here in John 12:31 says, now it's the time of judgment on this world. Now the prince of this world will be driven out. That's Satan. Satan rules over this world and hell. Demons. What are demons? Demons. A demon is considered a spiritual entity that may be conjured and controlled. Satan is the leader of these demons who send them to tempt us and deceive us. We've all been tempted. We've all been deceived. We've all been lied to. So today, I'm going to convince you hell exists by not pulling out verses, necessarily. I will do that at the end. But first, I'm going to share about someone who I believe the devil and his demons have control. Why? Well, if I can convince you that demons can tempt us, which we are tempted daily, so then there must be a ruler of these demons, said Satan, and there must be a place where Satan and the demons stay, hell. So grab your seat, because it's going to get intense. My experiences. Why not just talk about me? Well, I want to use someone that influences you guys, millions. Yeah, I might every once in a while I camp or if I come to church, but I want to relate. I will relate this to me towards the end in my personal struggles with Satan, but first I want to introduce someone who you've already been introduced to. That it's really, really some stuff. All right, Can anyone tell me who said this quote? You can read it if you want, I'm just gonna say it, ready? But in the midst of this insanity, I found my Christianity through God, and there's a wish he granted me. He showed me how to cope with the stress and hope for the best instead of being moped and depressed. I'll read one more time. But in the midst of this insanity, I found my Christianity through God, and there's a wish he granted me. He showed me how to cope with the stress and hope for the best instead of being moped and depressed. Anybody? Yeah, I didn't think anybody would know that. You do know. Oh, next slide. Eminem said that line, actually. That lyric was from a song called It's Okay off his first album, Infinite, which he sold out of his trunk of his car in 1996, prior to when I believe he sold his soul. Because not only was his voice different on the Infinite tape, but so were his lyrics. His lyrics were encouraging, uplifting, and he admitted that Christ was his Savior. But it never sold. It did awful. Now, let's listen to the very first track after his Infinite release. So he releases Infinite. This tape, he had great rhymes, and like I said, they were encouraging, uplifting, and they were able to relate with people going through struggles, because he said, in the midst of my insanity, it didn't sell well. Well, this next CD, it's called the Slim Shady EP, not the Slim Shady LP that you can buy in stores. This is EP. This was also something he released after Out of His Trunk. This also, the same tape that he released, he didn't get any credit for his Infinite tape. Nobody ever heard of him. He was done. I believe that's when he sold his soul, okay? All of a sudden, this tape from this guy in Detroit that's only rapping at the St. Andrews Club gets Dr. Dre. Is that a coincidence? Not at all. That's another reason why I believe he sold his soul, because just listen to the intro track. This is the intro to his mixtape. Right after his CD, less than a year later, it said he was a Christian. Till Hell Freezes Over, this was released on a mixtape. He says, I'm in the voodoo tarot cards and Ouija boards, lighting candles, camping out at haunted beach resorts. I write about the dark stuff, that's an edit, and rap about perverted violence, ghost stories of people murdered on deserted islands. I make music to make you sick of fake music, hate music, like devil worshiping Satan music. So say your prayers, your Hail Marys and Jesus's, take two sticks, take them together and make a crucifix. It's from a song called Devil's Night, off the Devil's Night LP, American Psycho. Each thought's completely warped. I'm like a walking, talking Ouija board, speaking in tongues I've never spoke the speech before. Hemdeli la and nignore. Have you ever experienced spirits and lyrics when you hear them? Too you're scared to stare at any mirrors when you near them? If so, get ready for some stuff, yo. Is this some kind of sick joke? Shoot, no. Mother freaking schizo, speaking in tongues, mocking someone who speaks in tongues. There's a verse, Mark 3:29. Anyone who blasphemizes against God, that sin will never be forgiven. And then even here, when he mentions mirrors in that clip that I just played, the devil is constantly telling Eminem to look in mirrors, and he also tells him that in another sense, because anytime Eminem looks in the mirror, that's when, I mean, the devil shows that, you know, Eminem is no longer free. He's chained to him. Next one. Say goodbye to Hollywood off the Eminem show. It's like the boy in the bubble who never could adapt. I'm trapped. If I could go back, I never would have rapped. I sold my soul to the devil. I'll never get it back. I just want to leave this game with level head intact. Next lyric, careful what you wish for. This is off Relapse, released about a year ago, right before Recovery. It starts off the song with this lyric, so this is it. This is what I wished for. Just isn't how I envisioned it. Fame to the point of imprisonment. Fame to the point of imprisonment. He's imprisoned. He feels like he's in jail, almost in chains, but Christ freed us from this chain, so there's no reason to be in prison. The chorus goes, so be careful what you wish for, because you just might get it, and if you get it, then you just might not know what to do with it, because it might just come back on you tenfold. What he's saying is, you know, he wished for success, he wished for fame. After infinite flops, he wanted that, and he said, just, you know, be careful, because it's going to come back on you tenfold if you go to the extreme measure that he did. Deja Vu, this is also off Relapse about a year ago. Maybe just a nice cold brew, what's the beer? That's the devil in my ear, I've been sober a freaking year, and that sucker still talks to me, he's all I can freaking hear. Marshall, come on, we'll watch the game, it's the Cowboys and Buccaneers. And maybe if I just drink half, I'll be half buzzed for half of the time. Who's the mastermind behind that little line? With that kind of rationale, man, I got half a mind to have another half a glass of wine. Sounds asinine, yeah, I know. But look at this. Look at this. This is exactly the temptations that we go through right now. The devil tells us, look at this. Maybe if I just drink half, I'll be half buzzed for half of the time. That's temptation. That's what the devil says. Maybe if you just look at a girl with lust like this, or maybe if you just drink one beer, this and that. That's, and Eminem is speaking about the temptations that he's going through because he's in this. He's in this. And just like right there, to have what kind of rationale, man? I got half a mind to have another half a glass of wine. I mean, it's just, it's poetic. There's talent, no doubt there's some talent behind this. Unfortunately, it's not being used for God's glory. Not Afraid, that's off Recovery. I thought I had it mapped out, but I guess I didn't. This freaking black cloud still follows me around. It's time to exorcise these demons. These mother effers, or suckers, are doing jumping jacks now. The reason why they're doing jumping jacks is because he's exorcising these demons. He took 4 years off, he did get sober, but now he's back. And also on Recovery, he has songs called Love the Way You Lie. There's Ten Commandments up there, says you shall not bear false witness. So Eminem's saying in a song title, I love the way you lie, God tells us not to lie. Eminem also has a song called No Love. That song is with Lil Wayne and talks about getting revenge. We talked the first night about don't get revenge. God is love. Eminem has a track called No Love. He has a new song with Nicki Minaj called Romans Revenge. We learn in Romans not to have revenge. And it's just coming up all over the place. If you really look into these lyrics and not just sing them, just because they're on the radio, you find some pretty heavy stuff. This next song, it's called My Darling. Has anyone ever heard this? A couple people have. This is off the Relapse CD. About a year ago, he's still sober at this time. They said he actually wrote this song during the time of Not Afraid and a couple Recovery songs. And this is get intense. So just first verse isn't too intense. The next two are.
Yeah. Look. If I were to rap about the crap that's out, that's the route you probably want me to take. Cause you're just dying and know what I think and my take on some other rappers. If I was to say something about Pow Wow, you'd probably grab in your pants. Cause I'm white and he's white, so he's like my competition, I mean, right? Nope. Paul Wall is dope, and so is Bubba. So, but I don't compete with nobody. I just go hard do the rope-a-dope, Ali shuffle, and dance around my opponents, do donuts. Sometimes I play possum, like I'm asleep, it's awesome. I'm like a sleeping giant, and when I wake, I'm like Dre. I just jump from out of nowhere and bite prey. I sink my teeth in them and fill them full of poison and make a noise like a snake before I kill them. And let them know that I just don't feel them, and smack them with the back with ease. Eminem and Bellum, I was taught if you're gonna murder somebody, you should face them. Tell them why, look them dead in the eye, then waste them. In the dark shall emerge from the fiery depths of hell, to swallow the shallow, the hollow who dwell in the shadows of all who are willing to sell their souls for this rap game. And it goes 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. That ain't the hook, now follow me. There's nothing else for me to say, my public adores me. Everybody bores me, they just so corny. So at night before I sleep, I look in the mirror. The mirror grows lips and it whispers, come nearer.
My darling, I don't ever want you to leave me. My darling, you and me were meant to be together. My darling, and if I cannot have you, no one can. You're my darling, cause I possess your soul, your mind, your heart, and your body. I don't ever want you to leave me. My darling, you and me were meant to be together. My darling, and if I cannot have you, no one can. You're my darling, cause I possess your soul, your mind, your heart, and your body.
Sweetie, I know you in there somewhere. Come here, talk to me, sit here, pull up a chair. Why don't you brush your hair? Dye it back, come on, try it.
Ah, no, I told you, leave me the f*** alone, will you?
But I'm here to rebuild you.
But I already killed you.
But Shady, we were meant for each other. Think about your mother.
Yeah, so what of her?
Well, think about what she did to you and your little brother. All them foster home.
You, mother. I had you beat.
No, I was playing possum, remember? I let you watch your little girls blossom. I gave you enough time, your soul's mine. I'm taking it back.
You why?
Because I love you, look a little closer. Isn't that us on that poster?
My darling, I don't ever want you to leave me. My darling, you and me were meant to be together. My darling, and if I cannot have you, no one can. You're my darling, cause I possess your soul, your mind, your heart, and your body. I don't ever want you to leave me. My darling, you and me were meant to be together. My darling, and if I cannot have you, no one can. You're my darling, cause I possess your soul, your mind, your heart, and your body.
Shady, listen. You hear that? They're screaming for you. I can bring your career back.
But I don't want it back.
Yes, you do.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do. You're gonna regret it later.
No, I won't.
I'm gonna get Dre on the phone. I'll just call the doctor.
Go ahead. I already talked to Dre yesterday.
Well, I got him on the phone right now.
Slim. You're lying.
Yo, Slim.
How? Why now? What up, Dre?
Check this out, Slim. I gotta talk to you. I don't know. It just seems like ever since you got off your drugs, you became a lot softer.
But Dre, all Sadie is a bottle of hair bleach and vodka.
Well, just think about it, Slim. I'm here. Just hit me back and let me know what's up.
This mirror.
I'm not in the mirror. I'm inside you. Let me guide you.
You die, you son of a...
Put the gun down.
Bye-bye. Okay, I'm still alive.
So am I too. You can't kill a spirit even if you try to. Soldier, soul to me. Need I remind you? You remember that night you prayed to God you'd give anything to get a record deal? Well, Dre signed you. This is what you wanted your whole life. Marshall Wright, boom. Look at this house. Look at these cars. They're so nice. Woo. Oh, but you didn't know fame has a price too. That you just now seeing the downside too. Lose your best friend from high school. Your wife too. Ain't even sure if your kids like you. Come off tour, can't even sleep at night without NyQuil. Become a value maddict, start a rehab cycle. But together we can break the cycle. Marshall,
why?
No one's gonna love you like I do.
That's intense. When I first heard that song, I like cried, you know. It's a reality that we don't want to admit, we don't want to face. But when Satan is real, his demons are real. And like he says in that song, you know, fame has a price, and if you do sell your soul, you will get cars, you will get all that. You will lose people along the way. Satan in that song says, you know, you lose your best friend, which was proof from D12, who lost his wife. And it's just, it's one of those things that it's nothing to play around with, but it's very real. Katy Perry, we all know, she wanted to be deemed the Grammy of Music. At age 15, I don't know if you guys knew this, she released a gospel record under the name Katie Hudson, but it flopped terribly. So in an interview, she admitted the only reason she is famous now is because she had to sell her soul. She left her family because her dad is actually a preacher. She had to leave her family. She said the devil promised her a great body, fortune and fame, and better vocals. And so she switched Kanye West on BET with the award show on the Cypher. It's this thing they do before the awards. He says, "I sold my soul to the devil. I know it's a crappy deal. At least they came with a few toys, like a Happy Meal." He also has a video out called Power, where it is very symbolic about Satan and Christ's return and how it's going to be a big spiritual warfare up until Christ's return. Snoop Dogg, and it has a music video all about how he sold his soul and the devil promised him that he would have eternal life. I thought it was interesting. Katy Perry said single has Snoop Dogg as a featured guest because let's not forget, Satan does have power, not as much power as God, obviously, but he will use whoever is willing to work for him to really just go after God and his people. Bob Dylan, a reporter asked Bob Dylan why he still goes on tours. Bob Dylan is very much older now. He replied, "Well, it goes back to the destiny thing. I made a bargain with the chief commander on this earth in the world we cannot see." I'm going to dig into some scripture supporting what I just showed you, what I just talked about. Matthew 4, 8 to 10, "Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain, showed him all the kingdoms of the world." This is Jesus here. "He took up all this I will give to you, he said, if you bow down and worship me." Jesus said to him, "Away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only." So Jesus was tempted. We're going to be tempted, guys. And some people have said yes to what the devil has offered. And when they do, they're not worshiping God. James 4:4, "You adulterous people, don't you know that a friendship with the world means enmity against God? Therefore, anyone who chooses to be a friend of the world becomes an enemy of God. If you become a friend of things of this world, money, success, power, all those things, you're not being Christ-like, and you're going to make yourself an enemy of God." Ephesians 4:29, "Do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. So should we listen to things that don't benefit us?" I mean, I'll let you guys decide, but if we're called not to let any unwholesome talk come from our mouths, then why it's not benefiting or building us up, then why should we listen to it? Romans 12:2, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." A lot of people say they do not understand God's will for their life. Well, if you read this verse, it says, "Then you will be able to test if you do not conform." So if you conform, you're not going to know God's perfect will for your life. Ephesians 5:1-3, "Follow God's example, therefore, as dearly loved children, and walk in the way of love, just as Christ loved us and gave us up for as a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. But among you there must not even be a hint, not even a hint of sexual immorality or of any kind of impurity or greed, because there are improper for God's holy people. Nor should there be obscenity, foolish talk, or coarse joking, which are out of place, but rather thanksgiving." It's interesting. Colossians 3:1-3, Since then, you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things, for you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. 1 Peter 1:13-16, it's kind of crazy. This is a verse we just read, and I didn't know Matt had it in there. But therefore, guard your minds, your act for action, keep sober in spirit, fix your hope completely on the grace to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, do not be conformed to the former lusts which were yours in your ignorance, but like the Holy One who called you, be holy yourselves also in your behavior, because it is written, "You shall be holy, for I am holy." Even we don't have to be a saint like Saint Augustine or Saint Thomas More or anything like that to be holy. As Christians, it says we are saints. And so we are called to be holy. So all these verses that say don't let there be sexual immorality, coarse joking, and stuff like that, if you're addicted to this and you're a slave to those things, then I would say that you are not holy yourself. Our calling is to be holy. We are called to be imitators of God. That's the Ephesians 5:1 verse. Now, I'm not saying if you listen to music that isn't glorifying to God, like Eminem, you're going to hell. That may be your own conviction on your heart, like God convicted me several years ago. Could this question answer most of the questions we have? What would Jesus, the Christ, the ruler of all, love, Prince of Peace, King of Kings, would he be listening to music from artists that mock him? And that Mark 3:29 verse is what I said. The only sin that cannot be forgiven is if you mock the Holy Spirit, which Eminem and several other artists do on a daily basis. Then you have the Mark 8:36 verse. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world yet forfeit his soul? That's exactly what's going on. Eminem, all these artists that have admitted to this, and there are other lyrics from other songs, they gain the world. They have money. They have success. They're popular. Everybody knows them, but they forfeit their soul. And the Bible wouldn't have this verse in it if it wasn't real. I showed you an example of what I believe is a man who sold his soul and wishes he could go back. Like he said, I wish I could go back. I feel trapped. Okay, what if I'm wrong? I guess only God's saying to him and then know if he really sold his soul. Let's say he did. Then you've got to believe in hell. No questions. Human evidence is there. The physical evidence right in front of you. You guys listen verbally. Let's say he didn't, and none of the other artists who claim to did. What then? Well, let me briefly describe experiences with the spiritual warfare that's constantly going on around me, and how the power of Christ, and how by the power of Christ, I've been able to stay strong and not conform to the world. I'm going to give you four different scenarios, and maybe you guys can relate, maybe you guys can't, but instead of using someone like Eminem, I'm just going to speak my heart. I had an ex-lady friend, ex-girlfriend, if you will. This was about 2 years ago. She was Jewish, and I really don't know why I dated her, except at the time I was lonely, and she listened to me. She was a cool girl. Really cool girl, except she didn't believe Christ died for her sins. She believed he did exist. She was Jewish / spiritual, she said. She believed he exists. He was a prophet. He didn't die, and then just got taken back up to heaven, and he still comes to this earth right now. It's kind of weird. But I should have been more mature, should have never even thought about it, but like I said, she made me feel loved. We started dating. I didn't introduce her to my parents because I knew I wasn't going to marry this girl, but it was just kind of, we were in four classes together, so it was kind of hard not to see each other. So eventually I dated, kind of conformed to the scenario, and one time I went over her house, and we were being very immoral when it came to the sexual act, and went over her house, her parents were out of town or something, and we start going at it, we start kissing and stuff on her couch. It starts getting pretty intense, but on the way over, I said to God, I was praying, I was kind of tearful because I was like, Lord, I'm just like screwing myself right now. Like, this isn't right. I know this isn't right. I need to get out of this. And I was like, just show me, like, this isn't of you. Just, I need some physical evidence. You know, it's much easier said than done in a lot of things. So as we're going at it, if you will, we're on the couch, and we're at this point, we're just kissing, and I'm like on top of her, and I like if this was her, like I like, you know, kiss her, and then I lean back like this, and I look at her, and I kid you not, God is my witness, her face turned into a satanic figure, and I threw her off, and I left, no questions asked. It freaked me out. Like, that was the scariest thing I've ever seen in my life. Like, her eyebrows, like, raised more than what they should. It was like an evil grin from, like, Satan himself. And it was just like, I got you again, Andrew. Just like that video we watched last night, the 3-2-1, turn around and look. It was like Satan up here, right in front of me. And, like, I mean, I forcefully just shoved her off. She didn't know what was going on, called me. I went and answered the phone, went home. I bawled my eyes out to my roommate at the time. That's some real stuff. And, so obviously that ended, and I don't talk to her much anymore, but yeah, that Satan can use people who aren't of the Lord. And next thing, YouTube ministry. I preach the gospel on YouTube. I do scripture verses, encouraging videos, stuff like that. And consistently, I get messages from like people, certain communities, some of the Muslim community, other communities, of sending me messages saying, you know, stop what you're doing or I will kill you. We will kill you. We will find you. We will kill you. Stop preaching the gospel. And most of the time, you know, I ignored or something like that. Well, as I was sending over my ministry, eventually after a couple hundred messages like that, you want to stop. It discourages you. When you start receiving more negative than positive feedback, the devil can speak through that and really get to your heart. And so I was sitting there meditating, and an advertisement popped up. And it said on the advertisement, it wasn't a pop-up window like normal. This was something different. I'm on YouTube. YouTube doesn't have advertisements on the side. They have advertisements within videos. But this was a pop-up advertisement. And it said, are you willing to sell your soul? Question mark. Yes or no? I wasn't even looking at material about selling your soul. I was like looking at messages about people had sent to me. And this came up as I was sitting there discouraged and stuff like that. And I was just like, why isn't this ever going to work out? And that popped up. And I kid you not, like goosebumps. I was just like, turned off my computer. And that was, and I believe that, you know, the devil's going to go after people who are holy because he wants to get them. He doesn't want people advancing the kingdom of God. Next one is sleepy time, about 3 a.m., which is ironic. It's also a song off Eminem's album, Relapse, where he talks about murdering people. But 3 a.m. is apparently the Satan's time, because apparently it's supposed to be kind of mocking 3 p.m., which is when some people believe Christ died. But 3 a.m., they said you can, and sometimes you can smell the coals and fires of hell. This is more of when it deals with exorcisms. That's when they said that this is really apparent. But I know at 3 a.m., when at me, if I'm still up at 3 a.m., Satan is consistently tempting me, telling me in my ear to look up porn, to do all these negative, bad things. And so to stray from that, I highly recommend not being up at that hour if you're going to be in the company by yourself in your bedroom. Elmfuge, last summer, not this past summer, but last summer, this is when God convicted me to get rid of all that music that I just played and listened to, because all those songs were once on my iPod. But yeah, I went, this is when we were in North Greenville, South Carolina. I went back to my room one night to pray and to read scripture and journal. And I pull out my iPod and put my little headphones in or whatever and click a song, because I wanted some encouraging music to write to. Some, you know, Matthew West or something like that. And it took 25 different clicks to get out of, like, Eminem, 50 Cent, Dr. Dre, all those guys to get something encouraging. And, like, all the 25 songs along the way were just mocking God, ripping God, you know, talking about sex, money, stuff like that. And I prayed over it. It put me in tears. And once I got home, I deleted it all. And so that was a big conviction on my part. Jesus spoke more on hell than any other preacher in the Bible. People may say, wasn't Jesus of love? Why would he speak on hell? For that exact reason. Because he loves you. He doesn't want anyone made in the image of God to go there. James 2:19, you believe that there is a God. Good. Even the demons believe that. And shudder. So guys, it doesn't matter if you believe in God or not. It's living for God. There's the belief is, yeah, I believe in God. But that doesn't mean anything to me. If I can see that you're living for God and the devil sees, that's a big thing. Even demons believe in God. Revelation 3:16, so because you are lukewarm, neither hot nor cold, I am about to spit you out of my mouth. It's funny how people are so quick to quote John 3:16 and they may not even recognize Revelation 3:16. That's fine. You can stay on this book. Okay. Basically, you know, John 3:16, for God so loved the world, you know that verse. Revelation 3:16 said, yeah, you might know a verse, or you might do this, you might do that, but if you're lukewarm water, it just sits there. You don't want lukewarm water in your cereal. You want cold cereal. You know, you don't want it, like, weather like this. You don't want to take a lukewarm shower. You want a nice hot shower. So Lukewarm does nothing. It just sits there and looks. And so if you're a Christian and you're lukewarm and you're just sitting there, it says here, you're going to be spit out of the mouth like a dragon. And God says, I would rather you be hot or cold. I'd rather you go against God or be 100% for God. Don't rattle the fence. Eventually you fall off to one side. We cannot approach the good news unless we've heard the bad news. And that's why I'm talking about this today. C.S. Lewis, famous author, used to be an atheist, converted to Christianity, believes that the doors of hell are locked from the inside. So just think about, or are locked from the outside, I'm sorry, locked from the outside, yeah, I should say outside, rather than the inside, meaning that the people in hell put themselves there, they send themselves there, meaning they could get out, but, you know, they don't because they send themselves there. The reason why I spoke on this was out of love. If I didn't love everyone listening right now, I wouldn't even mention hell, like some pastors and preachers and churches and friends and family don't. This is a subject that once the screen comes up, you're like, oh man, I probably should have left, or man, I don't want to be here. But if you don't want to believe that Eminem sold his soul, fine, don't believe that. Listen to whatever music you want. If you don't want to believe in my experiences, don't. You don't have to. If you don't want to believe what the Bible said about hell, that's fine. But morally, we know what's good and what's bad, right? What is bad? It's anything that's evil. It's anything against God. Murder, rape, stealing, adultery, lust, everything. So where does this evilness come from? It has to come from somewhere. And who tempts us with this evil? Take a look at your own life, your own sins, and see if maybe someone is tempting you. And like I've been said, who's the mastermind behind that little line? There's a mastermind. That's Satan. When we are tempted, the author of confusion, which is Satan, makes evil look so good. I mean, yeah, sex, drugs, all that stuff makes us feel good. There's no doubt about that. But that's not it. You know what I'm saying? Like, even if it makes us feel good, it doesn't fulfill us. And if you don't want to spend your life in a trap place of torment and pain, I suggest you turn to Jesus the Christ. Satan wants to devour you since you're made in his image. Don't let him. Give him hell.